Everything you're saying tonight could be said at a more convenient time, but you're choosing now. You're choosing now. Sleep has become this simple wish as my eyelids draw heavy, my heartbeat can't rest. These words are spiteful, but so easily said. How can you let my actions pass through the day, but throw them back at night when you say you no longer care? How I can't stay here, but you will know. You will go on your mouth and tie yourself out. So deep when we talked about committing eternally, you know I can't pretend as easily. I guess it comes from knowing me so well and graduating from the honeymoon spell. Every flaw is fatal. Have I put you through hell? How do you let my actions pass through? But throw them back at night when you say you no longer care. How I can't stay here, but you will know. You will go run your mouth and tie yourself out. Stamina anywhere else. I still got miles to go in this to and fro, but you will know that you will go on your mouth and tie yourself out.
Hello guys, my name is Kris. Welcome to the Thomann YouTube Gearhead University. TGU 18. We have the wonderful Mary Spender here in the studio.
Hi.
And first of all, thank you that you took some time for our video. And you've just heard Mary play one of her songs. Mm-hmm. And there are some very obvious questions and maybe some not very obvious, but kind of questions that make a lot of sense to ask. So let me just get right into it. First of all, on a personal note, I love your style. What's very interesting that you, the way I see it, you combine a sort of finger picker folk kind of Brit American kind of pop folk stuff mixed into singer-songwriting style of arrangements. Mm-hmm. was it just like happening, or did you get influenced by certain artists that come that way together? Or
yeah, well, I definitely in terms of influences, and the reason why I picked up a pencil from the store was because of Mark Knopfler as well, because obviously he has a few of these amongst his Fender and Gibsons. But in terms of finger style and the sort of chicken picking that he does, yeah, that okay. totally influenced me. But the best way to come up with a new style is to fail at something like that.
Okay.
And then you do your own thing. Same with John Mayer, very, very influenced by him.
Yeah.
Hearing Stop This Train for the first time, I'm suddenly like, oh, right, okay, that's interesting. I'm going to try and mimic that again, fail at it, come up with a unique way. But in terms of accompanying myself as a singer-songwriter, playing bass notes and then, you know, playing lead lines too, it's just quite freeing.
Yeah.
I still play with a band sometimes.
You do? Okay.
And I sort of adapt my playing for that, and they adapt to me too. But yeah, it's sort of trying to be as self-sufficient as possible.
Let's start with the obvious question, because, you know, it has to be asked. Were you struggling mixing both? I mean, you studied guitar, right?
No.
No, really?
Mm-mm.
Oh, I kind of thought I heard something.
I studied viola at university.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I thought it was guitar.
Yeah,
okay.
No, I've never had a guitar lesson.
And it was a classical...
Yeah, classical upbringing.
All right.
So I played piano, singing, and viola. So I was playing in
there
orchestras and string quartets, but I was a terrible soloist. Terrible. I got bow shake all the time, very nervous player. But singer-songwriting, I was still doing it all the way through that.
Right.
It was like my antidote
your
to all
secret,
the classical.
Secret love.
Yeah, exactly. Although it wasn't so secret, because I'd insist on performing in front of everyone, as singer-songwriters like to do. But yeah, so I was restricted by the classical world, and I wasn't hardworking enough really to succeed in it. I didn't practice enough. And I just didn't. I didn't take to it as easily as picking up a guitar.
Okay.
So I was stubborn enough just to pursue guitar in the evenings and weekends, play in a heavy metal rock band as well.
Instead of practicing.
Instead
your
of practicing
piece.
Viola.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But yeah. So that's.
And what was it a struggle at the beginning? You know, playing guitar. Obviously, at the beginning, you have to, you know, concentrate on the chords and your picking and everything. But as you developed and you went probably more and more into this kind of let's sing and play together, was it an easy thing, or did you have like something kind of a method you found out for yourself, or just happened?
I definitely worked at it. Definitely.
Obviously.
It always felt natural. Like I sat down with a guitar and started to write songs on guitar immediately. So like learning chords, you know, chord progressions, and then trying to make a song out of them. So singing at the same time as playing them. So getting the basics down, it came quite naturally in terms of what I was practicing.
Yeah.
But then I would do things like I don't do it as much anymore, but it's still quite a good thing, because obviously if you've got a microphone in front of you and you're trying to play lead lines at the same time as well as doing all the things that I try and do, you don't look down when you're practicing by yourself. You're looking down and you're seeing where you're going, but when you're trying to perform as well, you need to look out, or I actually often close my eyes now, which I never used to do. But I practiced in the dark.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I'd sing my songs in the dark so that I couldn't see anyway. So, you know, and then you just learn where you were and where you were needing to go and stuff.
Yeah.
And then it didn't matter whether you had lights shining in your eyes when you were on stage,
sure.
which can throw a lot of people off. Because I could play with my eyes closed and it wouldn't matter.
Wow.
I could have just closed my eyes, but
that's
instead I just turned off the lights.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
Would have been more efficient, but you know,
yeah,
it has a certain romantic to it, like
yeah.
turning off the light and being really forced not to, like, you know, sneaky peek, you know, shortly opening the eyes. It's like, you know, off you go. No chance to check out, you know, and have a visual, you know, help.
Exactly, you can't cheat.
Yeah. All right. I mean, that's a very good advice. And obviously, you just start with simpler stuff on the guitar and try to sing to it, to get the timing right, to get the bars right and have the feeling.
Yeah. Well, actually, to be honest, in terms of timing, when I first started out, I was playing with a plectrum and I was still trying to play intricate things and nice chord progressions and in a percussive style. But my timing was totally off. So I would, if as soon as I was nervous, I would rush through a set. So a half hour set would turn into 20 minutes. Or if I was doing an open mic and I only had 10 minutes, I'd do two songs and be like, all right, is my time done? They'd be like, no, you've still got time. I'd be like, oh, I don't have any more songs, so that's it. When it should have just taken 10 minutes. So I had to work at that. And the tool that taught me timing in a live environment was a loop pedal. So playing acoustic guitar, I was trying to do the percussive thing, trying to build up a band just with the body. And so that set me in stone. And I made all the mistakes too in terms of rushing the loop, hitting it at the wrong moment and then having an out of time loop. You know, I've done all the mistakes.
That's a great skill.
But now that I don't use a loop pedal and I really try and just do, you know, and I still, you know, I have a bad habit of being percussive and hitting my thumb, but it keeps me in sync. And I still rush. I'm a singer. We all rush. but yeah, it's sort of grounded me a bit more. And I've done it enough now that I can take a deep breath and just try and stay in time.
While you're playing, do you pay attention to any part of the whole stuff, like singing or guitar playing or left hand or anything, or the tempo or the text, you know, like, oh my god, I really have to get my own lyrics right, you know, or is it just let's go and feel the flow, you know?
Yeah,
enjoying yourself.
Often if I think about anything, then it throws me off. As soon as I started thinking about lyrics, like earlier in the filming session, yeah. I'm like, no, I can't remember anything. And I become a blank page, where it's better if I'm just, I don't know, yeah, the flow. The difference between sort of practice and then turning that into just it naturally happening and muscle memory and that sort of stuff. It's important, and especially for singing too. So not only just remembering where you're going on the guitar, but remembering when to take a breath and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
That has to
come,
it has to be natural. Otherwise you'll end up singing far too long or
just singing like a robot, you know, without enjoying yourself while you're singing, because you concentrate on too many things. So
exactly.
I mean, these are a couple of really cool advices for some of you want to go into this direction, not even singer-songwriter. I think also like being a guitar player and doing backing vocals, which is, it's not even close as hard as being a solo performer like yourself, but it's so many struggle with it. I played with super guitar players and so like, that song, I cannot sing backing. It's not
gonna
work.
Going on.
Like, I get it, but I kind of can, and it's not because I'm such a huge talent. I just tried and tried, and then it worked out. So
and it's why I don't shred.
Yeah.
one because I can't, but also because I haven't ever had the need to. I haven't just been a lead guitarist. When I have played session, I've just been rhythm, and backing vocals. It's fine, you know. I'm able to do that, but as a solo performer or. When you see Sting playing bass and singing at the same time, because it's one thing playing guitar and singing, but playing bass, because it's so rhythmic and so important, and especially the things he does. So it's sort of watching those sorts of guys and then thinking, right, how do they still perform whilst doing all that?
Yeah.
You know, and trying to be as efficient as possible. It's super interesting to watch.
Absolutely. So a personal one. Why electric? Why not acoustic guitar? Just simply why not?
To be honest, I think with all my choices, I've tried to just go against what people might think that I would do. So it's, you know,
think out of the box.
Yeah, and also the electric guitar is so interesting, and you know, other players have done it before me, singing and just playing electric. It's not completely original. But there's still so much, you know, in terms of effects, in terms of guitar tone, it just changes the whole singer-songwriter genre.
Absolutely.
I still play acoustic. I write on acoustic. If it works on acoustic, it will translate to anything. I don't write with effects. Sometimes I'll be inspired by something to then simplify it and then use that effect later.
Yep.
But yeah, I toured a lot with acoustic because it was so easy, you know, to plug in and play. You know you're going to get a consistent sound, whereas it's a lot harder with electric and, you know, not being able to take an amp with you all the time. But now it's, yeah, I love electric. Like, I started on electric as well. My Pacifica 112 was my first guitar that I bought, so.
Best starter guitar.
You know, yeah, and then I went to acoustic because I think I sort of tried to fit in. And then in terms of then starting electric guitar, which I only switched back in 2015.
Really?
That's yeah, a long time ago. I found the electric guitar for me, which was a Vigier GV Rock. And I saw it at NAMM, and my whole world was changed of seeing the industry behind electric guitar, really. And now, you know, even this time last year, I didn't know that much. And it's just been an education, really, and talking to other guitarists about what they use and what they don't use, why they don't use it. And then, you know, my choice of amp, my choice of guitar. Vigier aren't particularly known for singer-songwriters at all.
Just as Orange.
Just as Orange aren't.
Aren't, yeah.
But that's why I chose them, because at least then I'd be special to them. And people looking at me on stage, they'd be like, why?
Yeah.
Yeah. Because if I was playing a Strat and I was playing through a Fender, it would be like, yeah, all right.
No more questions asked. Yeah.
But
it's like the obvious choice.
I like asking questions and being asked questions. So
I mean, that's really weird. Your blue guitar, which is green, as you told
Revolution
you're
green.
Correcting me, which is a beautiful, that's your Vigier, right? That's
yeah.
your
yeah,
guitar.
That's my guitar.
What people most know from you, which is a humbucker guitar.
Yeah. Why that too?
Exactly, yeah.
Why? I don't really have an explanation other than I liked that guitar, I liked the way it sounded. Splitting it and just the five-way switch, there's just so many different tones in that guitar. It can sound like a Strat, but sometimes it just doesn't. And it's just, you know, it's just quite a versatile instrument.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah, I own an Indus as well by Vigier, which has the little Thunder pickup in, so that was useful, especially playing solo, so I could have bass underneath, plug into a bass amp too, so I've got an Orange for that. And that's a beefy sound. But in terms of scale length and body shape, I love the GV Rock. I just keep going back to it. It's 24.8, so it's just, you know, 25.5. I don't know. I don't know whether it's hand size or just what I'm. I don't know what I'm comfortable. What it is, but it's just.
I think it's a combination. It's not only hand size and neck shapes. I think it's also. The way, you know, the strings are stiffer because they're longer.
Yeah.
So obviously that's the biggest problem when many people have playing.
Well, that's strange because I play 11s on my 24-bit.
Oh, all right. Yeah. So these 10s should feel just normal.
Yeah.
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 So it's around kind of like in balance.
Right. Okay,
the
that
longer
makes sense.
With the 10s and then the shorter with the 11s, mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, it's, you know, it's pears and apples.
Yeah, I know.
Great. One more thing, what I really wanted to ask is how do you write songs? Do you think of chords and harmonies, or do you think of melodies and search for the fitting bass tones? So, you know what I mean? Is it more like the melody that comes in your head and then you grab a guitar and start to shape, you know, the harmonic content? Or is it more like fooling around, finding like a cool progression, mm-hmm. and then, you know, singing some melody on top of that? Or is there like no concept?
No, it's getting pretty consistent now. It's fooling around and playing, sitting down and playing, and it's why I don't. It's why I'm really bad at practicing the guitar, because I'll start down, I'll sit down and then just start playing, and I'll be like, okay, I'm gonna work on this today. I'm gonna work on the pentatonic scale, and then I'll find something and then I'll start writing a song and I'll get completely distracted. And that is why I can't shred.
Side track.
There we go.
Yeah, yeah,
because
yeah.
I start singing.
Yeah.
So yeah, like the song "Run Your Mouth" that I was playing. If I turn on the guitar, I started with the tuning. So I detune the A string down to a G. And I was just starting with that, and then. Probably just playing something like that, and then and then... And then I'd probably just try and discover where to go next.
Yeah.
And then...
Came
and then the melody came, and then I realized I could sing it and play it at the same time, and then it just became a thing.
And then, you know what? Which part I really like, the at the end, you sing without the guitar once the melody, and then you come again back with the guitar, but then you go on a second line with the vocals and keep a tone, and the guitar stays, you know, at the melody. It's like it opens it up, and it's like that's a beautiful, you know. Development in the song.
Thank you. Yeah, and it's just, it's using the guitar as another voice. So if I can't pay a backing singer, I as well use myself as a backing singer.
Figures, leave, so, let's
leave the guitar as the main thing. But yeah, that song particularly, it sounded like a double bass just fell down.
I hope not, but something just fell over. Maybe someone's getting impatient because they want to come in, because our time is over, unfortunately. So guys, check out Mary's channel, Mary Spender. You'll find her on YouTube right away.
Just type it in.
And subscribe to her channel, subscribe to our channel, and check out everything coming out from TGU18. And, you know, as told, comment. Don't forget to comment down there somewhere. If you have any questions, we'll come back to you. And see you soon.
Bye.
Thank you, Mary.
Thank you.
Cheers, guys.